It's 3:30 p.m, school's out, and for these 35 children, after school club's about to begin at the local Salvation Army Hall. They live on Guernsey, the second largest of the Channel Islands. The French coast is just 25 miles away, and 60,000 people live here. The last few decades have seen huge changes in the island. Industry's changed. The long-established export of vegetables and fruit, including the famous tomato, has been all but abandoned. Nowadays, Guernsey is best known as an offshore tax haven. The finance industry is the island's largest employer. The Salvation Army has been here since 1881, and Clifton Hall in St Peterport is a local landmark. Yes!
Despite it being an affluent island, there are still some families who can't afford to pay childminders for their children after school because they're at work. And childminders is quite expensive for them.
Tom, you not have one?
There are a lot of people who are affluent, who are comfortable. There are a lot of people who, you know, are not, and who struggle and who find daily living, you know, a real problem.
While the differences in lifestyle are evident, there is a shared history which unites the islanders.
One of the things that's still very real in people's hearts and minds is the occupation of Guernsey by the Germans during the war. That's left a huge impact in their life, and you know, there's not a week goes by really that we don't hear memories of the occupation.
Marcus Gaudion was only 9 at the time, but he still remembers it well.
Our first experience with the Germans was when they bombed the St Peterport harbour on the 28th of June. Quite a few people were killed, amongst whom was my uncle. And we just did not know what to expect because we had heard so many different stories of what was happening on the continent, and we wondered whether the same fate would befall us.
2 days after bombing St Peterport, the Germans occupied the islands. As well as being strategically important, capturing British soil was a significant propaganda victory. The occupation has left a permanent mark on the landscape. Massive fortifications and gun platforms were constructed all around the coast as Germany moved one step closer to mainland Britain. To build them, slave labourers were brought from all over occupied Europe.
We used to see them going along the street, their feet literally bound in rags. They were in a bad way, and then they would be queuing up at the lunchtime with their little billy cans or whatever to have a bit of watery soup, and we felt very sorry for them under their circumstances.
Within a year, the German forces closed down the Salvation Army and ordered Salvationists not to wear their uniforms. With their corps closed, Salvationists attended other churches.
We ourselves went to the Lille Methodist Church along with quite a few other people, and we settled down quite well there.
Most people in Guernsey were treated well and in return were compliant. People kept their heads down and got on with life as best they could. But a section of the German Occupation Museum is devoted to a Salvation Army officer who refused to keep quiet.
Marie Ozanne came to Guernsey having served with the Salvation Army in Belgium. But with the imminent invasion of the Low Countries by the German forces, she felt it was safer to come back to Guernsey, her home, and see her parents, who were both elderly Salvation Army members.
When the order came banning the Salvation Army and the wearing of uniforms, Marie was outraged, and in an act of deliberate defiance was the next day on the steps of St Samson's, preaching in her uniform. For a year or so, she continued to preach, and the German authorities turned a blind eye. But then, Mary started protesting about the torture of the slave labourers as well. In the summer of 1942, she was arrested, imprisoned, and, many believe, tortured. When she fell dangerously ill, she was released into hospital. Within weeks, she was dead. She was 37.
Well, the morning of the funeral, I called at the Cattell Hospital, which was known as the emergency hospital, to gather the remains of Major Ozanne. We brought her in a twin horse hearse to the Vale Independent Cemetery for a graveside service. We were advised not to have a church service. Whether that advice came from the Ireland authorities or from the German forces, we still do not know. But I've been requested that we would keep it as quiet as possible.
A lot of Salvation Army people felt that she was very foolish in preaching at such a dangerous time, and she was endangering them. But in the hindsight of history, she must be regarded as a heroine today.
In 1947, Mary was awarded the Order of the Founder. At St Samson's Citadel, General Albert Osborne presented the medal to Mary's parents. 60 years on, and in a joint venture by both corps on the island, St Samson's Citadel, where Mary Ozanne preached, is being reopened as a community centre.
It gives me great joy to declare open this new project, which is for the glory of God and for service to people.
To be able to stand up for what is right, regardless of the cost, is something that, you know, the modern believer in Britain doesn't really have to consider, but in those days they did. That the Salvation Army survived intact is a testimony to their own faith commitment.